Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this episode. And actually, today I've just followed my subscribers' request. One of the subscribers, actually three, not even one, asked me to discuss today about influencer, owing to the fact that we are approaching, or actually we are in the flu season. And I have something simple about influencer. I'll start with the definition of influencer or flu. Influenza is actually what people mostly call flu, and it's a highly contagious viral infection caused by the influenza virus. We have two types of influenza virus, type A and type B, and both of them have subtypes. Type A is usually can be transmitted from animals to human beings and human beings to animals, so is vice versa. And but type B is only transmitted from human beings to human beings. So that's one of the differences. And type A actually is the one that causes a more serious infection or a serious disease in human beings. It has actually caused pandemics in different parts of the world, and the subtypes, it depends on the subtype and the virulence of the subtype that is causing disease. So in terms of transmission, it's transmitted through mainly through the respiratory route, and it's transmitted through respiratory droplets, like when someone coughs or sneezes. But then this is not limited, because if someone touches a surface and they have the virus, maybe in their hands, and another person comes and touches the same and touches their mouth or nose or eyes, they'll still get the infection. But the main route of transmission is through the respiratory route, when someone coughs or sneezes in front of a person who is not infected and they are infected. So in terms of symptoms, flu actually develops rapidly and presents with the symptoms of can present with a fever, sore throat, a dry cough, nasal congestion, or a running nose. And these are the same symptoms that the brother of flu, you know, a common cold, the cold, usually presents with. It presents with the same symptoms, but then the symptoms of cold is actually an unspecific viral infection, and we don't know exactly the virus that causes cold, the common cold, and it's transmitted through the same way. And actually, for a cold, the symptoms come gradually, and most of the times they go without any treatment. So that's the difference. Of course, when you compare flu with the current pandemic of COVID-19, coronavirus is usually transmitted through the same, almost through the same route, mainly through the same route, that is respiratory route. And when you compare the symptoms, they are almost the same, because corona also presents the dry cough, a sore throat, and fever. But then, you know, to differentiate them, like during the current pandemic, if you got those symptoms, you have to be tested and know whether you have to do the PCR test for influenza or the PCR test for coronavirus to differentiate between the two, so that you are sure which one exactly you're ill with. So let's go to other than specific symptoms. Like in children, you'll find them having diarrhea and vomiting. These symptoms should be observed. They should be, you know, like you should not just say that a flu will present with a cough or a nasal congestion only. For children, it might present with the diarrhea and vomiting, which are gastrointestinal symptoms. So let's go to prevention of a flu. The first method of preventing flu is through the vaccination, which happens most parts of the world. It happens yearly, and this vaccine, the vaccine mainly used is the inactivated influenza vaccine, and it's usually remodified each year to suit, you know, like to accommodate the virus strain causing infection that year, that is causing severe disease that year. So each year we have a vaccine, and this vaccine actually is indicated for people from the age of 6 months onwards. And which are the groups, you know, like which are the groups that are highly advised to do the vaccination? So we have healthcare workers, because they interact with so many people in the hospitals. We have school-going children, but mainly under the age of 5. We also have people over the age of 65, because they are having a weakened immune system. And we also have other high-risk groups, like people with diabetes, people who are infected with HIV, people who have chronic lung disease, including but not limited to asthma and chronic pulmonary obstructive disease, COPD, people who have heart disease, people who are having kidney disease. Those are people who have a high risk of transmitting getting severe disease when they get influenza infection. So these are the groups that should be highly advised to go for the vaccination. That's one thing, vaccination in prevention. The next thing, cough etiquette. When you cough, when you sneeze around people, it doesn't matter whether you're infected or not infected, you're supposed to observe the cough etiquette. You cover your mouth and your nose when you're coughing, and yes, basically that. The other thing is hand hygiene, because when you go touch somewhere where someone is touched and they're infected with the flu virus, and you touch your mouth, touch your nose, you'll still get the infection. So observe hand hygiene. You either hand wash or you sanitize your hands with a sanitizer that contains alcohol. So that's another thing, hand hygiene. You're also supposed to limit your contact. If you know you're infected with the influenza virus, you have the flu infection, you're supposed to limit your contact with the people who are not infected, like in the family, in the community. You're supposed to limit your contact so that you don't infect other people. The other thing is, in terms of prevention, is cleaning, like at home, cleaning the surfaces that are mostly touched, so that maybe the children will go and touch their mouth, touch their nose. So you clean the surfaces and make sure they are, every time they are, not contaminated. So now we'll go to the side effects. Before I go to the side effects, contraindications. Who are not supposed to get this vaccine? Because most of the times, you know, people just go to hospital and they don't know whether I'm supposed to get it or whether I'm not supposed to get it. Of course, this is something you should get from your healthcare provider on whether you can get the vaccine or not. But there are specific groups of people who are not supposed to get the vaccination. And these include, 1, people who are less than 6 months. Those are infants less than 6 months. People who are allergic to the vaccine. And by allergic to the vaccine, I mean people who are allergic to components of the vaccine. Like people who are allergic to chicken egg. I cannot get the vaccine. 3, we have people who are sick, who have a severe or a mild illness at the time of vaccination. They should wait until the infection clears so that they can get the vaccination. 4, we have people who have developed paralysis after getting the vaccine previously. And this is called Guillain-Barré syndrome. People who get paralysis, is usually ascending. It starts from the feet and goes up. So people who get paralysis after the vaccine, getting the vaccine, then they are not supposed to get vaccinated again, because they might now develop the actual paralysis. So we go to the last thing, which is the side effects of the vaccine. Mainly, the vaccine is usually administered for adults on the upper outer arm. We have a muscle there. It goes directly to the muscle, so you can get pain and the swelling of that around that area, but then it's something that will just resolve on its own. For the infants or younger children, they go for the vaccine on the anterolateral thigh, that is the outer side of the upper thigh, and the same symptoms. They can present with a slight fever, they can present with the swelling of that area, and some people actually develop flu-like symptoms which will clear. But what you advise as healthcare providers is that if you develop symptoms and they are overwhelming you, you can seek help from your healthcare provider. And these symptoms can also be managed symptomatically. Like if you have pain, you can take analgesia, but then don't limit yourself. You should consult also with your healthcare provider. So this is about flu. And last time we talked a few things about COVID-19. So this flu, the presentation and everything, it's almost like the COVID-19. We've stated that for both of them, the preventive measures are almost the same. Apart from now, people with people in this pandemic, people are observing, the restrictions are more strict, such that even if you're infected or not infected, everyone is observing, the set guidelines in different parts of the world. But from me, the message that I'm going to leave you with, we are in the middle of a pandemic, and again, we are also in the flu season. We are approaching, or actually we are in the flu season. So basically, I advise you to take all the measures. Keep your distance, put on your mask, observe hand hygiene, and don't go out when it's not warranted, and keep safe. Next week, we shall be coming with a new topic. We have so many topics that people actually gave us. So next week, we shall be coming with a new topic, and we will be hoping to see you, and we encourage you to also advise your friends to subscribe to our channel so that we be informed, all of us be informed and, keep healthy. And up to next time, I would like to say thank you for subscribing, thank you for watching, and thank you for being part of this family. And I hope to see you next week. Thank you very much. Have a good afternoon today.